Good morning, everybody. In this lecture, I want to give an introductory overview of what Bayesian networks are and what you can do with them. But I will not go into all the details of how they work technically. Actually, there are in Europe several research groups that do fundamental research about the theory of Bayesian networks. And one of the groups is in our university. It's led by Professor Linda van der Gaag. I will say more about this later in the lecture. Bayesian networks are ways to represent human knowledge about human expert knowledge about some specific domain. And in this way, they are a little bit comparable to expert systems. Perhaps you know that many expert systems work in a rule-based manner. That means that you express relations between phenomena in by means of rules. And I will try to show that Bayesian networks can do the same things, but they are stronger than rules. They are more exact. I will say something about probability theory and then introduce the Bayesian networks as a means to represent knowledge. I have some examples, but probably I cannot treat them all, but we will see how far we get. And if you have questions, I'd rather go into things that you want to know about than the things that are programmed in my presentation. So please feel free to ask questions. In many domains, knowledge is uncertain. Relations between phenomena are uncertain. And as a small example, we consider the problem of distinguishing between two types of bags with marbles. Assume there are two types of bags. A bag of type A has 250 red marbles and 750 blue marbles, while a bag of type B has 750 red marbles and only 250 blue marbles. But we don't know what bag we have, and we want to find out by taking samples of the bag. Good, so we do that, and we take 5 balls from the bag. And as a result, we see 4 red marbles and 1 blue marble. And what would that tell us about the type of bag that we have been investigating? This question is, well, the answer, of course, is you cannot know for sure, because drawing 4 red and 1 blue would be possible from both type of bags. But we can compute probabilities and say that if we would draw 5 marbles from bag A, then the probability of this outcome would be only a little bit more than 1%, while if we draw this from bag B, the probability would be like 40%. And this would lead us to the conclusion that the bag we are investigating is of type B. However, there's a lot of hidden assumptions in this conclusion, because first of all, the whole idea that bags of type A and B exist is only a presumption. And how do we know that for sure? And we don't know, we do not even know for sure that bags of type B exist. And we also do not know how the selection between a bag A and bag B was made in the first place. So this experiment, this way to distinguish between a bag of type A and bag of type B, is only meaningful in the context of a assumption about what types of bags exist and how the selection between those bags was made. And basically, this distinguishes the classical statistics from the Bayesian statistics. In classical statistics, we have ways to assume some hypothesis and compute probability of certain outcomes from that. But what we want to do in Bayesian statistics is also the reverse. Look at the outcome of an experiment and then try to find out what is the most likely hypothesis that can explain such an outcome. However, I cannot overstress the importance of the a priori assumptions, because Bayesian statistics needs a priori assumptions about how likely certain things are. And it basically turns out that the outcome of a network is very much dependent on the a priori probabilities of certain outcomes. Now, that means we are going to speak about probabilities. And if you ask what is probability, then like the question, what is time? This almost has no answer, or to put it otherwise, it has many answers. And there is, for example, the frequentist view on probability, and the frequentists view probabilities as a relative frequency of occurrence. So if we would go to a birth clinic and look at the babies that are born and determine their color of hair, then we could wait, for example, for 100 babies to be born. We find out that 30 of them have blonde hair and 70 of them do not have blonde hair. And then the frequentist would conclude that the probability of being blonde is 30%. But the subjectivist would say, well, there are many things for which we cannot repeat the experiment. Like, what does it mean if the weather forecasting station says that tomorrow there's a rain probability of 30%? There's only one tomorrow. So here the probability would be interpreted as an amount of belief. There is a slight belief that it will rain tomorrow, and this is expressed as a percentage, which is then the probability. Well, mathematicians, of course, are not going to take part in such an argument, and we say, well, we don't know what it is, but we know how it works, and we can put that into axioms, and then we have probability theory, like the Kolmogorov axioms for probability theory, where we simply say we have a set of states, set of possible outcomes, and to each of the states we assign a number, and the sum of these numbers must be one, and that's then a probability distribution. Now, what we consider is states that are composed of the values of several variables, because the more interesting things come when we relate several several aspects of a case to each other. So, for example, we could not look only at the hair color of a baby that is born, but also look at the hair color of the mother of that child. And now we have two variables, both with two possibilities, binary variables, which would give us four possible combinations. So we have a state space consisting of four states. And if the relative frequencies or the probabilities of these states are as in that table, we have a distribution over these states on two variables. The whole theory also works for multivalued variables, but in this talk I will only consider binary variables. And now one of the most crucial points in the development of Bayesian networks is that of dependency and independency. And it's often the case that dependency is defined in terms of equality of certain probabilities, but in the decision theoretic view on dependency. Dependency is a matter of does it help to have some evidence or not? And to give an example of this, again here I have my distribution of blonde and non-blonde babies. The first table gives the 30 and 70%, which are the probabilities, the overall probabilities of all mothers combined to give birth to a blonde or a non-blonde baby. Now in the second table, you see that I have split out these numbers over the blonde and the non-blonde mothers. So you see that if I wait for 100 babies to be born, then about 30 of them will have a blonde mother. In the third table, the one below, the idea here is that I wait a little bit longer until 100 blonde mothers have given birth, and then if the probabilities scale up in the right way, we will see that if we wait for 100 blonde mothers to give birth, then we will see 50 blonde babies and 50 non-blonde babies. So you can see that the lowest table basically is a similar table, but now not for all mothers, but only for the blonde mothers, and you see that this table is different. Because with blonde mothers, the probability for a blonde child is larger. And basically, the numbers in the lowest table are what we call the conditional probabilities, and we can find them by taking the numbers in one row of this table, so it's basically the numbers that hold for blond mothers, and we rescale this whole row by dividing each number in this row by the overall weight of this number to get a sum of 100%. And so basically we find that the conditional probabilities, the probability, for example, of a blond baby given a blond mother, is equal to the probability of the combination, the one found in the table here, divided by the overall weight of one row of this table. So the conditional probability is the probability of the conjunction divided by the probability of B, and this can be rewritten as saying that the probability of A and B is equal to the probability of B times the probability of A given B. And that's an asymmetric formulation. So we have seen that in my example, there's a probability for a blond child, but children of blond mothers have a different probability, so we say that blondness of the baby and blondness of the mother are dependent. But if we look, for example, at whether the child is a boy or a girl, then we see that for 100 children, we have 50 boys and 50 girls, and half boys, half girls, and for blond or non-blond mothers, this is the same. So if we want to know if the child is a boy or a girl, it does not help us to look at the hair color of the mother, because knowing the hair color of the mother does not help us to give a more precise estimate of the gender of the child. And that basically explains dependence or independence from a decision-theoretic point of view. If I want to make some decision that is based on the hair color of the child, then it will help me to know the hair color of the mother. If I want to make a decision that should depend on the gender of the child, it will not help me to know the hair color of the mother. And now the idea of Bayes' rule is that we can compute back from data to a hypothesis, because what the classical statistics does is it will compute, given the assumption that we have a bag of type A, it can compute us the relative probability in this table of either getting the outcome 4 plus 1 or another outcome. And the same holds for bag B. So for bag B, we will have, if it is bag B, we will have this probability of 4 plus 1. So basically what the classical statistics does, it gives us the distribution of numbers in one row of the table. But in the experiment, this is quite useless because we do not know in what row we are. The only thing we know is we know in what column we are, because we know the outcome of the experiment. And basically what Bayes' rule does, Bayes' rule allows us to recompute from row distributions to column distributions by basically making use of the fact that the probability of A and B can be expressed in these two ways. You see that in this formula I have the probability of A, here I have the probability of B, but here I have the two conditional probabilities, the one of B given A and the one of A given B. So basically I can compute the probability of 4 plus 1 given back A, or the probability of 4 plus 1 given back B, and now if I want to find the probability of a certain bag given this outcome, I can invert these conditional probabilities with Bayes' rule. Now, how can phenomena be dependent? Well, basically an important reason for dependence, of course, is causality. If you go to a party and you drink a lot of beer or vodka, then you might have a headache the next day. And this is clearly caused by a medical phenomenon that alcohol induces some changes in the body which will lead to headaches. So it's very well possible to see that if I ask 100 students if they have a headache, perhaps 6 have a headache, but there was a party the night before where there were 50 people, And then, for example, of these 50 people that went to the party, 5 have a headache. And of the 50 people that did not go to the party, only 1 has a headache. This is clear a causal phenomena. However, the dependence does not really have a direction. Because I can also say that the a priori probability of going to the party is 50%, but the probability of going for the party for people who have a headache is 83, and the probability of going to the party for people with no headache is 48%. So if I only look at the numbers in the table, only look at the states, then I could equally well say that headaches make students go to party than saying that party causes headaches. Basically, the correlation does not have by itself a direction. And this is also a possible explanation. For example, if it is a party of headache patients, then yes, it's clear that more people who have headaches are a member of this patient society and would go to such a party. So in principle, it's difficult to, well, it's quite natural to think of correlations in terms of causality, but it is not so easy to distinguish where the causality is, because the correlation does not tell you anything about the reason for such a dependence. It's also possible to observe a correlation between phenomena that do not cause each other. And you might think, for example, that if you go to a party, you will not only get a headache, but you will also spend a lot of money. So it's quite likely that the day after you go to a party, you will be broke. You will have no money. So now we have a phenomena which is going to a party, which might cause as well headaches as emptiness of wallet. And this phenomena may induce a correlation between headache and being broke. And the relation between phenomena that are that have a correlation may not always be causal. Now here the nice thing is that in the population as a whole, we would observe a dependency between headache and being broke, while if we split the population in guys that have been to the party and guys who have not been to the party, then in each of these subcommunities there would be no correlation, no dependence between being broke or being having a headache. Now it's also possible to have a phenomena that is the other way around. It's possible to have two phenomena that are not related, but they have a common effect. And if the effect is such that it has a higher probability of occurrence if both of the two phenomena A and B occur, then we may have a very strange situation that there is no dependence between A and B, no dependence between A and B, they are independent. But if I look at the subcategory of people, of cases that satisfy C, I do have a dependence. So in this situation, we would have independence in the whole population, but dependence in the two subpopulations. While in the previous example, I had dependence in the whole population, but independence in subpopulations. And these two examples show that while between just two phenomena, I can model this with either one thing being dependent on the other, that is does not make a difference, that is has the same amount of oppression. Well, if we have more variables, then it might be relevant in what direction I consider the arrows in my network. My network, I will speak about this now, because the idea is that we will model the phenomena, the variables in a network, like we are doing here. And the network will basically have all the variables that consist the state. And like here, for example, Here is a small model of the party example. There is a party, and probability of going to a party is not influenced by anything. So I have just put there that the party probability is 50%. And from there, there are arrows both to the headache variable and to the being broke variable. And here the idea is that the probability of a headache is dependent on whether the person has gone to the party. So we have a different probability either for party attendance or for non-party attendance. And it is the same for being broke. In my second example, I would draw the arrow the other way around. I would put A and B as independent phenomena on top. And the common cause of these two would be modeled by a variable with two incoming arcs. And now the idea is that for each of the four cases that we can have for the combination of A and B, I would have to give a probability for this C. So basically, the Bayesian network will consist of a directed graph, which must be acyclic. It's an acyclic directed graph on the set of variables that we consider. And the arrows basically indicate a direct form of dependence. I say a direct form of dependence because, in fact, between A and B there may be a dependence, but it is only between via this variable C, and it's in the top picture is the same way. Headaches and being broke may be dependent, but that's only via this intermediate variable PA. What information do we need in the node and in the graph? The network describes which variables there are and what the domains are. Well, in my example, they are all binary, so it's nothing to describe there. The statistical influences are modeled by an acyclic arc set, and then for each variable, I would have a so-called conditional probability table, and it would describe the probability of the variable, but for each of the possible configurations of its parents. Like in the example here, this variable C has two parents, and that means that there are four possible states of the parents, four combinations, and for each of the combinations we must give the probability, and the same occurs on top there. Like the PA variable has no incoming arcs, so it only has one probability in its table because, that is basically its probability is not influenced by the truth or falseness of any other variable. And we see here that the information that we have in one node is exponential in its in degree. So for a node with k incoming arcs, I would have to put 2 to the power k probabilities in its probability table. And now I can compare this with rules in a rule-based expert system. And for dealing with uncertainty, there is in the expert system world, there is the idea of having certainty factors in the rules. So, for example, the idea that going to a party may cause a headache can be modeled with a rule in a rule-based expert system. And one would say, for example, if student X attends the party, then he will have a headache the next day, and there is a certainty factor attached to this conclusion. So basically, the idea would be that if I find out that X has been to the party, I will not with certainty conclude that he has a headache, but I will add 0.10 to the strengthness of the conclusion that he has a headache. That's basically the idea. However, rules are expressed in an if-then manner, and the fact that I'm putting a confidence factor here does not change the fact that it works only in one way. Because if a student has a headache, I can do nothing with this rule, because the rule is activated only if the antecedent of the rule is found out to be true or to be established with a certain degree of confidence. So for a guy who has not attended the party, I will know nothing about his headaches. And for a guy with a headache, I can not go back to the possible cause of the headache. However, the Bayesian model is in this sense stronger, that if I establish this link from a party to a headache, I must give a probability not only for having a headache in case he has been to the party, but I must also give the probability of a headache in case he has not been to the party. So the model of a Bayesian network basically enforces me to consider the two cases, has been to a party and has not been to a party, and to put some information in the network for both cases. And that will allow me to reason back in the network by means of this Bayesian rule. Basically, the information that is now in this network will allow me to draw a conclusion for somebody who has been to the party about his headache, but also, if I know a person has a headache, this will tell me something about whether he has been to the party or not. So I can go in two directions because of the information in the networks is more complete. It's richer. And now, what kind of arcs are there in a Bayesian network? I hope I made clear that the arcs in a network are correlations, and that means that they are not necessarily causal relations between variables. However, if we ask a human expert to tell us what he thinks about a certain domain and to put his knowledge about the domain in a network, then we find that experts often think in terms of causal relations. So it will often be the case that arcs in a network work will coincide with the causal understanding of the domain of the expert. But this is not really necessary from the point of view of the theory of the networks. And now the idea is that if there are n variables, then basically the Kolmogorov idea of a probability distribution is that the probability distribution consists of 2 to the power n numbers. Well, there's some redundancy there because the 2 to the power n numbers must sum to 1. So speaking with Kolmogorov, I would say that if I give 2 to the power n minus 1 numbers, then the probability distribution is completely determined because the last number is just the complement of 1 with respect to the numbers given. But in any case, that means that the amount of information that is present in a distribution can be quite large. But if we look at a typical Bayesian network that can represent a distribution on those variables, then typically the in degree of a node is 2 or 3. Well, this is not absolute law, of course, but it's something that we see a lot. And that means that, 2 or 3 in degree means that per node we will give 4 or 8 parameters, the conditional probabilities. And so the whole distribution, basically consisting of 2 to the power n parameters, is represented by 4 to 8 n numbers. So the representation of the probability distribution is very efficient. And the theory is that once we have made a network, because it is acyclic, you can prove that it uniquely defines a probability distribution over the set of states. And then we can ask, what can we do with this represented probability distribution? Well, in Utrecht we have a decision support systems group, and it is led by a professor, Linda van der Gaag. I know that here in Slovakia you like it that you can see from the name whether it is a man or a woman. Can you guess whether this professor is male or female? Yeah, with name Linda, this is a female professor. And she has the idea of Bayesian networks go back to it's invented by a person named Perl around 1988. He has written a very famous book about this, but Linda has taken up this subject around 1990. So since about 20 years, we have this group in Utrecht, and the focus of the group is the development of support tools. And also we use the expertise to build actual Bayesian networks, mostly in medical applications. And this is one network that has been under development over the past 10 to 15 years in Utrecht. It's a network that helps in the treatment of esophageal cancer. This is a quite severe disease. It relates about 40 phenomena with each other. And here is one note that is related to the stage of the disease. And it turns out that if you have this specific type of cancer, then it can be in six stages. So this variable is a six-valued variable. But you see that here are also states that are variables that are binary. And you see here all the arcs in the Bayesian network. And now the idea is that if somebody is, turns out to have this type of cancer, then we can include evidence about him. For example, here is a variable called passage. And this variable indicates whether the patient is still able to swallow food. Well, a healthy person is able to swallow solid food. But if you have a cancer in the in your throat, then you might may not be able to swallow solid food, but only, for example, liquid food or no food at all. And this can be indicated by this variable here. Now, the idea is that all the red nodes are instantiated, and that means that the doctor has found out for this specific person what is the value of this variable. And you see that in the red nodes, exactly one of these bars is completely filled out. Basically, the idea is that if we determine for this patient that the variable has this value, then that means that it's for 100% certain that this is the value of that variable. While the blue ones are uninstantiated, and here the columns, the bars indicate the probability distribution that this variable has at this moment. But the length of these bars can change by entering more evidence about this patient. Now, how can such a model be made? We often first start with investigating what kind of knowledge exists in a certain field. And for example, in a medical journal, we may find information about metastatic cancer. And it says there it may be detected by an increased level of serum calcium. Well, so basically the idea is that a metastatic cancer may lead to an increased level of serum calcium. And then we can try to put all the things that are mentioned in this article together. But you see there, it may be detected by an increased level of serum calcium. So here the uncertainty comes in. It is not certain that somebody who has this metastatic cancer will have an increased serum calcium. It is possible. It may be the case. So that's why we need this to model this by a probabilistic arc. And then if the knowledge has been put together in form of this network, then we need to establish the probabilities, and this can be done by data mining or by collecting probabilities from the medical literature. Well, what type of inference can be done? It's possible to compute the probability of a state. So if we consider a complete state with a value for each of the n variables, it is quite easy to compute the probability of this state. But it is most of the time it's more interesting to compute probability distribution for each variable, and that's what we call the marginal probability. So, for example, we would like we can compute for each variable what is the probability, and we can also do with this network sampling. So we can generate by probabilistic means a sort of representative list of cases satisfying the probability distribution that is encoded in the network. But it is in a consultation, we will look not only at the probability distribution of the whole thing, but we will also look at the evidence that we know for one case, and we will enter it in the network. And that is what happened in the example that I've just shown. After entering, we can we obtain something like a network that that will represent the distribution over the variables that we do not know. Well, actually, that is what we would like to have, but that's not what we obtain directly, because you see that these red nodes are still present in the network, and for each computation with the network, we still have to deal with these nodes. But the nice thing is that propagation can go both forward and backward. In like a classical expert system that is based on rules, one can only reason from the antecedent of the rule to the consequent of the rule. But here you see that a node lower in the network is instantiated, and by means of application of the Bayesian rules within the network, this will lead automatically to an update of the distribution, the probability distribution of all the nodes that are higher than it. So for the network, it does not matter whether I instantiate a node in the top of the network and will try to find out if this person has a certain disease, what will be the consequences for him. No, but it also allows me to observe what is he suffering from, and I can compute back, say I can swim against the causality and find out what is the possible, most probable disease that he is suffering from. Well, then to indicate some of the research questions that have been addressed in our group. There is, for example, the question of test selection. The basic theory of Bayesian knowledge, Bayesian networks, tells you how you can enter evidence and recompute the probabilities in the network. But especially in medical domains, obtaining the value of a certain variable induces a test that you must apply to the patient, and tests cost money, and also they cause pain or discomfort in the patient. And not all the tests give you equally much information about the thing that you actually want to know. So Danielle, one of our PhD students of several years ago, has made a study where she can apply an algorithm to the network that balances the cost of a certain test in terms of money and patient discomfort against the expected shift in the probability distribution of the goal variable. And so she was able to give an automated procedure that will, at a certain stage in the consultation, give a suggestion to the doctor what is the most the most suitable test to apply next to the patient. Then there's the research by Johan Wisthout. He has studied complexity of questions about networks, like design questions, and he has found out, well, he has used the fact that Boolean formulas can be coded as Bayesian networks, because if there is a Boolean combinator, like a disjunction or a conjunction, you can make a probability table that reflects the true-false value of such a table. And this allows us to take a Boolean formula and sort of encode it in a Bayesian network in such a way that if we enter variables that satisfy the formula, then a certain variable in the network will turn out to have the value true, while in an, if not, it will have the value false. And this allows us to basically take questions about Boolean formulas and reformulate them as questions about Bayesian networks. And using this, Johan has been able to find the complexity classes of many problems about Bayesian networks, like the monotonicity problem or finding out an explanation. These questions all turn out to have a very high computational complexity. This research was started in 2005, and Johan graduated just last month, about 2 weeks ago, actually. Yeah, the picture here is a little bit dark, but it shows our official room where we have the PhD defenses. It has portraits of former deans of centuries ago, and you see that Johan is dressed in, well, very official black suit. Yeah, this is how we do our PhD defenses. Another thing that was done in the group is writing a program tool called Dazzle, which allows to model these networks and to do the inferencing with them. And here you see also some of the research that is still going on. What is the sheet number? 20. There are some attempts to apply Bayesian networks to court cases. And this is not, well, this is a very good idea, but it is not something that people from the courts think a very good idea, because people working in the legal domain, in the forensic domain, often forget that what they are doing has to do with probabilities. And doctors remember this because for doctors, the probabilities are usually quite far away from one or zero. So, for example, you may have a certain sickness and the probability of a symptom is like 80%. And so this is far enough away from one that you realize that if somebody has a flu, he does not always sneeze. There's only just a probability that he will sneeze, but it is not certain. However, if we're looking at the DNA trace, the idea would be that two DNA traces of different persons have like an incredibly low probability of 1 in 10,000 to match. So that means that if somebody is innocent, but still the trace found on the crime scene coincides with the person's DNA, this has a probability of only 0.01%. And this probability is so close to zero that we often forget it. And this leads to interesting fallacies in the legal domain. And the overall problem is that forensic experts tend to think that they are certain about things, but in reality they are not. But I'm going to skip a few things here. There's there are some theories about some idealistic views about how probability theory can help in the court. It's like basically the idea that a judge who has to decide on a certain case should build like a Bayesian network and then enter all the evidence. But I don't actually think that this is all going to work in that way. But there is But still, in many cases, in the legal domain, Bayesian networks can help. And for example, there has been a development towards a Bayesian alcoholism test, where the idea is that if you drive under influence, then you get, of course, a penalty, which may be a financial penalty, or it may be imprisonment. But then, on top of that, people may lose their license. When this is not formally a penalty, but formally it's an administrative measure to protect society against people who are alcoholists. But the practice is that many people, of course, are more afraid to lose their driving license than they are to get a penalty of 1,000 euros. But anyway, a judge has to decide if somebody has found guilty of driving under influence of alcohol, whether this person actually is an alcoholist, suffers from harmful and hazardous alcohol use, regular alcohol use, or if this was incidental. And depending on that, he will void in the driver's license. And now the judge cannot decide that by himself, but uses the advice of psychiatrists who will investigate the person and try to determine if his drinking was incidental or habitual. And now what has been done is, this has been modeled by a Bayesian network. And well, actually it turned out that alcoholism has certain effects which can be determined by laboratory tests, but also a liver disease can cause similar symptoms. So the probability that somebody has a certain drug in his blood will depend both on whether he's an alcoholist and on whether he has a liver disease. Now, some people have worked for 5 years on this network. So they have investigated all these factors that are of importance. Now, for example, for having a liver disease, it's important whether you have a hepatitis risk, because if you have a hepatitis risk, for example, because you use heroin or something, this may increase the probability that you have a liver disease, which means that if you are positive on one of these tests, it is more likely that it will be because of your liver than because of your alcoholism. So they are putting together all these factors. And now, if somebody is found driving under influence, they're going to put everything that they know about the patient in this network. And eventually, this will lead to a certain percentage for the alcoholism, so that the doctors will be able to, well, to tell the judge whether you are likely an alcoholist or not. Well, how can you make such a network? The qualitative parts, you have to find out what things are relevant, what factors are relevant, what is related to alcoholism. But yes, once you find that, for example, it's relevant whether you have a liver disease, then also all the factors that can cause a liver disease become important in the network. And then the consultation is basically similar like the earlier consultations that we have seen. But there is a catch. Because, for example, one of the factors is a cage. And the cage is a questionnaire that the person has to fill in himself. Like you have to fill in a question about how often do you drink. Now, here it's already different from the medical domain. Because if I would have to fill in a questionnaire that is used to decide whether I have a certain dangerous disease or not, well, it's in my interest to fill in this questionnaire as exactly as possible. Because it's in my interest that the best diagnosis is made and then perhaps I can be treated and healed. But if I have to fill in a questionnaire and I know that it is going to be used for deciding whether my license will be voided or not, Well, then if they ask me how often do you drink, well, I write less than once a month, of course, because I know that this will increase the risk, the probability that I keep my license. So it's important to realize that the things that are questioned in the cage in this questionnaire are important to know, but they are probably not reliably obtained from the patient itself. Then these two persons in our department have written the DESL program. And with this program, you can basically, with mouse clicks, you can form nodes and put the edges between them. You can fill in the probability table, and then you can start running consultations. And one of the larger examples that has been developed in our department is this network for classical swine fever. You probably know that swine fever is a very contagious disease that can be had by pigs. And it's extremely expensive to have this. We had a swine fever outbreak a couple of years ago. It does not say here which year that was, but I think it was 2002 or 2003, because as a reaction on this swine fever, the Ministry of Agriculture started some initiatives to diagnose swine fever in an early stage. The outbreak at the beginning of this century cost our economy an estimated amount of 10 billion euros. And I know that, for example, the gross national product of Slovakia is around 50 billion euros. So the cost of one swine fever epidemic is about 1/5 of the national gross income of Slovakia. Well, we have a little bit larger gross national product. So percentage-wise, it was not 1/5, but something like 1 or 2% of our national income. But still, 10 billion euros is a lot of money, and there are other nice things that you can do with 10 billion euros than wasting it through swine disease. So there were several attempts to invent techniques that will allow an earlier diagnosis of swine fever, so that when swine fever is detected somewhere, there can be isolation measures earlier, so that the spreading could be protected or limited. And this network uses several things that have to do with the pigs. So this was implemented in little handheld PDAs. Veterinarians can go into a herd of pigs with this handheld PDA, and they can simply type in what they see of the pigs, and by instantiating the nodes in this network, it will give a certain probability that this pig was that he has this swine fever. And this network was developed in a period of about 2 years, and some 2,400 probabilities had to be estimated, and that's a lot. So that took some work. Fortunately, a lot of them were simply zero, but many of them had to be found in the literature or had to be assessed from veterinarian experts. Yes, and this network was tested in practice, and it is a project that is in cooperation with several countries in the European Union. And some other developments that we now want to do The question now relates to a single pig. So the questionnaire is at the pig level, which means that, for example, you have to look whether a certain pig was poisoned, whether one pig has problems with his nerval system. But what we would like to have is factors that relate to a complete stable of pigs, a herd of pigs, because those factors would be easier to determine. Okay, now I have spoken for about 1 hour, so I get to my conclusions. The Bayesian networks are a mathematically sound model to reason with uncertainty. And again, this I can contrast with the rules in a rule-based expert system. Rule-based expert systems work with these certainty factors, and these certainty factors are a heuristic way to give a quantitative strength to certain conclusions. But these quantitative strengths may be, well, useful in some applications, but they do not have a firm theoretical basis, so they are not a mathematically sound way to reason with several variables. But probability theory is. And these networks can be applied to areas where knowledge is statistical, like the medical domain, but there are also other domains, like the legal domain, where this can be applied. Making a model is more work than putting some rules in an expert system, but the result is a stronger model because the single formalism, a single representation of knowledge of a relation between parameters can be used both in a diagnostic and in a prognostic way. That means we can reason with using the same knowledge, we can reason from cause to effect, but also from effect to cause. Then there are some disadvantages, mainly that the model is quite transparent, but a single consultation is not. And what do I mean by that? Well, if you have a rule-based expert system that reasons about a certain domain, then in a specific case, you can trace which of the rules were fired. So that means that if in a certain case you arrive at a specific conclusion, then you can ask the system, why in this case did you reach that conclusion? And the system can tell you, well, I fired this and this rule, so in this specific case, it is this sequence, this line of reasoning, that led me to this conclusion. But in the Bayesian networks, you can enter evidence, then something happens automatically, which is not so transparent, and subsequently it will tell you the probability of the conclusion. And that is very powerful, but it is not very transparent how or why in this specific case the conclusion was reached. On the other hand, more research is being done to find out this question. And basically, we can say that Bayesian networks have an increasing popularity. So we have several courses in our program that are about these Bayesian networks. This ends my my presentation. Perhaps you have questions about this.
So we want to find in the case of Bayesian networks the ground of society. So maybe the same question, how is it possible to model real-life situations when some factors and people mutual influence?
The question is, the networks must be acyclic, and how is it possible to model situations where there is feedback between various variables? This is quite difficult to design a network for that, but as I have said, the direction of a single arc can sometimes be chosen one can think that there is a causal relation from A to B, but still this can be modeled in the network either with an arc from A to B or with an arc from B to A. So sometimes you have to play a little bit with the arcs in order to make the network acyclic and still represent the distribution that you want. Sometimes it's not possible to model a certain situation with very few arcs, and sometimes you need nodes with a very high degree, and these are disadvantages. These are bad, except for example here in this case you see a node with a very high out degree, and that does not matter. But nodes with a very high in degree are bad. Basically the structure of the arcs should not. I said that experts, when they tell you how things relate together, they often think in causal terms, but effectively the structure of the network should represent the dependence and independency relations. So sometimes you will choose arcs that are different from what is given by the expert as a causal effect. But it's not always trivial to find an acyclic representation. Yeah. But I think I cannot say more about that now. Perhaps there are more questions? How did we get the data? That is a very nice question, because it differs very much from network to network. In the network for esophageal cancer, the data was obtained by studying patients. This type of cancer is quite severe. Actually, it is the case that it is hardly treatable. But in our academic hospital, we have about 200 cases per year. Almost all die after several years. And the treatment is only has the goal of reducing the suffering of the patient. Basically, a treatment leading to curing the disease is hardly possible. But because we have 200 patients per year, there's quite some statistical data available about this disease. So then it is possible to take lists of many patients and actually obtain the probabilities from the statistical data or from guesses made by experts. However, with classical swine fever, it's completely different, because classical swine fever is extremely rare, fortunately. Because every time it happens, it costs us 10 billion euros. So it happens once in 10 or 20 years. And in this case, it was even difficult to find veterinarians who have seen a sick pig. Because once the classical swine fever is detected in some pig, this pig is isolated, it's destroyed quite quickly. But veterinarians are hardly allowed to approach these pigs because of the fear that he will get some of the germs on his hands or in his hair, and when he's going to treat other pigs, they may become sick as well. So there, it's very difficult, and one has to question very old veterinarians who have seen sick pigs 40 years ago, or base most of the probabilities on guesses made by the experts. So that's quite a different approach taken there. Good. Are there more questions? I told Linda, the professor, that I was going to teach here in Košice, and she liked that idea very much. And she said, oh, I wish I were you, and I would go to Košice. So I will try to work a little bit on her and convince her that it is actually very nice to come to Slovakia and teach here. So perhaps if you're interested, she will come here and give a series of lectures about this topic, which yeah, which would go much deeper into all these matters. Good, I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much.